But tonight, don't call it a comeback. I've been here for years. I'm rocking my pants, putting suckers in fear, making the tears rain down like a monsoon. Listen to the bass go boom, explosion. Overpowering, over the competition. I'm towering, wrecking shop. When I drop these lyrics, that'll make you call the cops. Don't you dare stare. You better move. Don't ever compare me to the rest. That'll all get sliced and diced. Competition's paying the price.
Hello, it's Ian McCauley here, and I'm back with another sports interview. I'm going to dip my big toe in the hot water today and take myself out of my comfort zone, which is boxing, and I'm going to attempt the interview a footballer. We're very privileged today to have young Tony Cain with us. Tony plays for Blackburn Reserves, and he has also been included in the Northern Ireland squad recently. Tony, thanks very much for coming here today to speak to us. The first thing I want to ask you is... You're 20 now.
Yep.
You've been with Blackburn now quite a few years. How long have you been with them?
Well, I moved over when I was 14, 6 years. Going back here on Monday. That's a game of 17.
Pre-season training. What I want to ask you is there any scene you're breaking through for the first team? And if not, do you not think it may be a better option to maybe move to a smaller club? You may be assured of first team football, something like Aidan O'Kane did with York?
Yeah, well, last year I ended up, at Christmas time, ended up signing a new deal. And I was on the bench against Arsenal, and was on the bench even before that in the FA Cup. And
wow.
I seemed to be breaking through a bit, and in March I got a bad injury in my knee. It kept me out till, I'm still recovering from it now, but everything's going all right. But we've got a new manager and all now, hopefully I'll go back and see what I can do and impress him.
Obviously, there'll be a reshuffle of things. You know, Paul Ince, another ex-Manchester United man. What was your relationship with Mark Hughes like?
Well, it was very good. He seemed to take a liking to me. He was the one who gave me two new contracts, and he had great promises for me, but he's moved on to bigger and better things now.
Right. Well, I don't know about anybody else, but I watch you out every week to see if you're going to break through. And I didn't know you were actually on the bench a few times.
Yeah.
That's very exciting. But I want to go way back now. You were an exceptional primary school footballer. I remember Mr. McGarrigy bums and blows about you. And if you make it big, I mean, he claims that he spotted you, that he nurtured you, he discovered you. And he likes nothing better than to talk about the 87 team, and particularly yourself. But we'll get to that later. Tell me how you progressed through secondary school. What secondary school did you go to?
Barney, so did.
Tell me how you progressed through to where you are now, from secondary school.
Well, I went there for 3 years, and I was at United School of Excellence for a bit, which Kevin really helped me get there a bit as well.
And great man.
From there, I went to Lisburn Youth. After I went up to United, the guy who runs United School of Excellence, he got me to go to Lisburn Youth. So I went down to Lisburn Youth, and at the end of the first season, we went to a competition in Derry. Then the Foy Cup, and at the end of the Foy Cup I had a couple of offers to go on trial, so I went over to Wimbledon, Newcastle, Sunderland, and went to Blackburn. And the second time I went to Blackburn again, they offered me a contract, and it was between Edmonds and Middlesbrough. So I decided I wanted to go to Blackburn because the facilities and the people there were outstanding.
Right. Tell me, over in Blackburn, where do you live? Do you live in a big house full of other footballers?
When you first move over, I first moved over, I live with two house parents. I went to school for a year and done my GCSEs.
Right.
And I used to
something like Jordy Best did, a family set.
Something like that. And on a Monday, he would do a full day, and Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursdays, I would go down and play football, but do school work. And after that year, you move into a big complex with 2 day room, and it's about 20 players staying with an R2 house parents looking after you. But everything's on camp. You do your pitches, you get your food, you get your washing done. You stay there for 2 years, and after that, if you're lucky enough to get an R contract, then you go and find a place for yourself.
What's your social life like? Obviously, all the footballers in the neighbourhood all be your mates.
Yeah.
And talk to me about your social life. And obviously, you must get very homesick too.
First year I was homesick, but then after that there I was fine. Like. But yes. Then I've got friends over, like big friend Thomas. He's over at Liverpool University. I go down and see him a few weekends. And my sister, she lives up in Newcastle. And she's married to a Jory lad, so we'll try and go up there and watch a few right. Newcastle matches with him and that.
Right.
So that's quite good. But I would go probably quite once, twice a month, probably just to relax and
right. Not there. I wouldn't claim to be, I would be a casual football supporter or football fan. I wouldn't be brainwashed like a lot of my mates. Mm-hmm. But I was asked to be on a panel of so-called experts a couple of years ago. And we're to determine the top 11 footballers ever to come out of Holy Cross.
Yeah.
And the likes of Argyll was on the panel. I think our daddy was on the panel yeah. too. Paul McNeil, Billiards. A lot of good fellas down. Covering every decade, really. But what I done was I went round and spoke to people who I would consider to be experts. Mm-hmm. People like Hugo McGee or Desi Flood or Jerry Graham or Gary Maguire. But now there was about five players walked onto the team, and the other six we had to agonise and debate over yeah. a period of weeks. But I remember you were one of the ones that walked on.
Mm-hmm.
But a few years ago, I was arguing with some kid in the street. And I says, because he was going on about an 87 team. And I says, the 76 team was the greatest team ever come out of Holy Cross. And I brought my scrapbooks down and yeah. showed them all the write-ups. I says, we swept the board. We won every match. We won the Northern Ireland Schools, the Primary Cup, the Telegraph Cup. Total destruction. Won every match. And with an Indian Oregon, bit of a debate, bit of crack. And he must have went back to the school and said to the teachers,
yeah.
the next thing Mr. Laverty called for me, and he said to me, could you get your team together? This is 21 years later, 22 years later, could you get your team together and play our team? I says, well, look, that's not fair, is it? He says, I know, but a bit of fun, a bit of crack, and it would be good.
Yeah.
So that's what happened. I got all with the players,
yep.
and you remember you yeah. played, and I was actually on BBC, came down and covered it. It was clips on the TV,
right.
and great man Joe Graham. Covered in full of rush light too also. But I remember it's tattooed, it's indelible in my brain, the goal you scored that day. That was an absolute powerful goal. And I think it said in the wee local Horizon magazine
yep.
that it was one of the greatest goals ever seen on a Ardoin pitch. I think that included the bone.
Debatable.
So but just were the second greatest team ever come out of Holy Cross.
The best team.
Holy Cross boys, manager of the school football team. This is Frank McCurdy. Also a teacher in Holy Cross Boys. He was the one that managed the 1976 team. Both our teams have actually done the clean sweep, won four trophies in a row. As you can see, today is such an occasion to be involved in for both of us, because it's the whole historical concept of it. You have the 1976 team, who have, what I said, they completed the clean sweep back in 1976, 21 years ago. Today I have an 87 team who are actually going to kick off against them. It'll be like father against son with Paul McNally, and nephew against uncle with Michael Hawkins. So today, sadly, there's going to be a loser, because these teams are both undefeated. They have never been beaten. Today one of them's going to go home beaten. But in the end of the day, there can only be one, and hopefully that'll be my team rather than Frank's. Thank you.
Right. The 76 team here, just to prove that they were the best. They, like the present team, went through a whole season, scored over 100 goals, went undefeated through their P6 and their P7 years. So it is quite an occasion for everyone. It's nice to see members of the 76 team here tonight. I haven't seen many of them in those 21 years. It's nice to see them again and to meet up with them, and we're looking forward to the occasion.
Well, thanks, Frank. I must say that he's very optimistic there about his team's performance. You got to remember that there's an awful lot of years in these people. I have young, fresh legs out there, very good whippersnappers. You just got to look out for the likes of Daniel McAlay, who is actually going to Manchester United along with Tony Kane. These are two fantastic young footballers, and I hope that they do very well in the future, and I wish them all the best, and I wish everybody in the Ardon community all the best as well, because without them we wouldn't be here today, and without their support I don't think my team would have achieved the high standards of success that they have achieved. Thank you.